Happy Sabbath, Church. As you can see on the screen, the title for the presentation today is The Everlasting Gospel. I'll start by saying that the devil was not happy for this thing to be preached here today. I'm not sure for who am I going to preach this today, because I know it by heart, and perhaps most of you know it by heart. I wanted to preach something else, but no, I was told to preach this thing for today. So somebody here needs to hear this message, and I would like those who know it by heart to be patient, knowing that somebody here needs to hear this message today. Before we go into the presentation, I would like to start with a word of prayer. And before I'm doing the prayer, I would like to tell you this. When we turn up this morning here, this
projector
was not working. Every time it's working, every Sabbath when we come here. Today, the lamp is broken. God prepared in such a way things that my wife was still at home, and we had a spare projector which kindly was donated to Hilda by somebody. And we kept it as a plan B, as a spare for moments like this. And it was just so easy to call my wife and say, bring the orange box, big orange box, which is the container of that new projector. And guess what? God is more powerful than the devil.
Amen.
If you looked carefully to the image on the screen, he's definitely stronger and more clear and more powerful than our normal projector image, which is not so clear. So this for me is a very good sign already. And was other things which interfered, which I'm not going to mention, just I'm telling you this, that devil didn't want this to happen. Now let's ask the Lord for his guidance. Our Father in heaven, in Jesus' name, Lord, we are coming as a congregation, as the body of Christ, to ask for the fullness of your Spirit, the Holy Spirit, to fill our hearts, our minds, and this room, that you may empower your word, which will be preached in your name, and maybe this word settle in the hearts of the people which are in this place here. Enable us to remember the words of peace and comfort which we will hear here today, and make us able to share the good news with others. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
The Everlasting Gospel. If we look to the cross on the screen, if you press once, yes. It says in John 15:13, it says, greater love has no one than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. Doesn't exist a greater love than this. And today we are going to look into this statement, and also we'll try to make a parallel to our own lives. As the scripture reading was saying, in Matthew 24:14, we read, and this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world for a witness unto all nations, and then shall the end come. I know there are people who wouldn't like the end to come. And that is not the thoughts of the Lord. The Lord would like to come. The Lord would like to settle the things. The Lord wants to bring an end to the suffering, to the trials, would like to bring an end to the death. Because we know that the other side will be no more death, will be an everlasting life. So, as we approach the end of time, this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world. And it's up to us to do just that. Now, when Jesus started his ministry, he said, very coincidentally, was given to him the book of Isaiah to read from it when he went into his town, into his village rather. And we read in Luke chapter 4, verses 18 and 19, what he read from the pulpit. And he read this: "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he hath anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He hath sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to preach deliverance to the captives, and the recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty them that are bruised, to preach the acceptable year of the Lord." I wonder if anyone here is poor. Not necessarily poor financially, but you can have the meaning of this word inside your heart. If you are somebody here brokenhearted, because this message is for you, I wonder if anyone here in this room is captive. And I know that most of us, we are captives to something ugly called sin. And we need to be set free from this. I wonder if anyone here is blind. Not necessarily blind to don't be able to see people around them and to read, but blind spiritually and feel the need of light. I want to see what is the truth. Is anyone here bruised in their heart? Jesus came to preach the acceptable ear of the Lord. I would like to go one step forward. He read from Isaiah. The interesting thing is, when we compare what Jesus read with the actual text from Isaiah, something is slightly different. And also something is missing from what Jesus said. And I would like for 1 second to discuss about this. So, if we go to compare the two texts, the one which Jesus read and the one from the original, from the prophet Isaiah, we can see highlighted the word good, no, the word gospel, in Isaiah it says good tidings. What is the gospel? Good tidings. Or good news. We can say in our modern language, good news. Anyone here needs to hear some good news? Also, the word poor. In Isaiah, it says meek, which gives a totally different meaning to the story, to the sentence. Let's read it. "The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord hath anointed me to preach good tidings unto the meek. He hath sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, and the opening of the prison to them that are bound, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord, and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all that mourn." Any idea why Jesus omitted to read the day of vengeance of our God? I wonder, when he was given the scrolls to read, what's like we have today different versions of the Bible? Like maybe he was reading from New King James, and in another village they would have the King James, and in another village we'd have the NIV, and so on. And maybe the meaning was a little bit different, but here is a kind of a sentence missing. So, any idea why he omitted to say anything about the day of vengeance of our God? Any thoughts? Was no time, was not the right time for that. You know when is the right time? When the full everlasting gospel will be preached unto all nations, unto the whole world. You remember Revelation 14, 6 to 12, the three angels' message? That is when he says the judgment has come. The day of vengeance is nearing. That is the last mercy message towards the world from God. And that was not his duty right then. He done what he was asked to do. So if you are meek, if you are poor, if you are brokenhearted, if you are captive, if you are bound, if you are bruised, if you are mourning, this message is for you. You know it in your heart. What is the purpose of the gospel? I pulled a few things out of this text, thinking about the gospel, and I came to this. The purpose of the gospel is to show the love of God for the sinner. Now, let's be honest with ourselves. When this world disobeyed, they lost the holiness. They were fallen from the grace of God. They were disconnected from the source of life. Imagine your mobile phone when you disconnect it from the PowerPoint. It's still 100% the battery. But slowly, what is happening? It's consuming the battery. Eventually, you will be like 2%, 1%, and it's happening what? It's dying, yes? Unplugged will not work. God could have chosen to crush this rebellious human family and to start afresh. But this is not the character of God. God chose, he made a choice to save these people. If you ever thought that is your initiative to search for God and to kind of give him your best, you are wrong. He searched for us first. It was his initiative to search and find that which was lost. It was his plan before we even knew it to put back together what was broken, to repair it, to fix it. Was he didn't take the easy path. Was very easy to just crush this thing, wipe it, delete the program, start afresh. No. He loves the sinner, and he wants to restore the sinner. That is a good news. That is the gospel. Another purpose for the gospel is it states the mission of Christ, of the Christ, to save the lost. If you look in the Old Testament, you will see that we know that his name is Jesus Christ by the New Testament, but actually is Jesus the Christ. Okay? The Christ is a title, is a job title. It's not the name. Many were called Jesus. But one, Jesus was the Christ, the anointed one. That is what it means, the anointed one of God. And we could see, He anointed me, God, the Lord, anointed me to do this mission. So He's saying, what is His mission? And if we are covered by His mission, if we feel we are covered, we all are covered by default. But if we feel we are covered, that gospel is for us. Also, it announces the great day of judgment. But He didn't insist on that. And that is essential for the follower of Christ. And the gospel is waiting for an answer from me. When I hear the gospel, what am I doing with this message? We read in Acts chapter 4, verse 12, that neither is there salvation in any other, for there is no other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved, apart from the name of Jesus Christ. That is what the Bible teaches us. And that put to shame all the religious, other religions, pagan religions, or even Christian religions, which are giving honor to the dead, or to select a group of saints, considered saints, and ask for forgiveness of sins and for salvation from these people. All this is idolatry, is wrong, is against the plan of God, and is bringing shame to God. Is just declaring to God that he is not enough. He is not good. He is not powerful enough. That's why you need something else, someone else, to help. And that is a lie. It's a lie from the devil. We need to resist it. There's no other name under heaven given among men in which we must be saved. Let's see a statement from Jesus Christ in Matthew 11, 28-30. He says this to all of us here in this room. Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Is anyone here in this room that is very labored, is tired, is heavy laden, and needs some rest? Spiritually, emotionally, physically? I think we all are at different levels, even if we admit it, or we don't admit it, we need that rest. And he says something interesting. Take my yoke upon you and what? Learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart. And you shall find rest unto your souls, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. He is calling us to come unto him, to learn of him, to take his yoke upon us. What that means? What that means?
He can give us peace.
He can give us peace, but how?
Trust him.
It's a relationship. He says, come to me. Don't stay there away. Come to me. You are in need. You need something. Come and ask for it. To him who asked, it will be given. To him who knocks, it will be opened. Yes? This is what he says. We need to come to him and ask. He is able to give us rest, and he is more than happy to do that. In Isaiah 53, verses 2-6, we read something really sad. This is a prophecy about Jesus and his mission, about his life of self-denial, about his suffering, and about his death in our behalf. It was prophesied in advance for those who will meet him to recognize him. And sadly, they didn't. But even that was prophesied, that they will not recognize him. Listen this. For he shall grow up before him, before God, as a tender plant. What would you think, what would you say is a tender plant? Maybe a little wire of grass? Yeah? That would be a tender plant, yeah? Something which is just coming up of the ground. Yes? Tender plant? Yeah? Did he came like a baby? Did he come like a king and... No. He came like a tender plant. And as a root out of a dry ground. He hath not form nor comeliness, or like no beauty. And when we shall see him, there is no beauty that we should desire him. There was nothing amazing about him, nothing special which you say, wow, this is the king. That should make us think how we treat the people around us. Because he came like nothing special, like one of the others, and was special. I wonder if people around us are special. He is despised and rejected of men, a man of sorrows, men acquainted with grief, and he did as it were our faces. We hid as it were our faces from him. He was despised and we esteemed him not. Surely, when you read this first time, you feel like crying. Surely he had borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet we didn't esteem him stricken, smitten of God and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him. And with his stripes we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way. And the Lord have laid on him the iniquity of us all. How amazing is that? If we have a big burden of iniquities, if we are bruised, if we are wounded, stricken, afflicted, he is more than happy to take it all to him and to give us the rest and peace we need. Only if we want to make this transaction is that simple. For this reason he came. This is what he wants. You have a pain, give it to me, he says, and I'll give you my rest. When in Mark chapter 1 verses 14 with 15 we read, now after that John was put into prison, Jesus came into Galilee preaching the gospel of the kingdom of God. Notice that he's preaching the gospel of the kingdom of God and is saying, time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent ye and believe the gospel. What is he preaching here? The time is here. The time is now. The time has come. The kingdom of God is at hand. Why was the kingdom of God at hand? Because they could see him, was in front of them. Repent ye and believe the gospel. Do we have something to do? We need to do our part as well, right? That is to repent and believe the gospel. If we don't believe the gospel, what we can expect from God? If we don't believe him, that he is that good to forgive, that is that good to bring us safely to the eternal life, how can we expect anything from him if we don't even believe he exists and he can help? In Matthew 16, 24 with 26 we read, then Jesus said to his disciples, if anyone desire to come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whoever desires to save his own life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. For what profits to a man if he gains the whole world and loses his own soul? Or what will a man give in exchange for his soul? That's a deep one. You see, when you decide in your heart to follow Jesus, you are starting to kind of swim against the current of the world going in one direction and towards down, and you're trying to swim uphill against the current. That is a hard work. If you want to have an easy life and you go with the world, what will happen? You will lose your life, the real life. But he who loses his life for Jesus' sake will find it. Why should you should you lose your life for Jesus? Isn't that a good question? What can happen that you may lose your life for Christ? That kind of is telling us that it's an uncomfortable message which you bear. Your way of being is different than the majority. You awake strife around you by being with Christ. I mean, let's be serious. He done nothing wrong and he was crucified. Why would we expect any different if we follow him? Why would we expect anything different? In Matthew 10:37-38 we read, "He who loves father or mother more than me is not worthy of me. And he who loves son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. And he who does not take his cross and follow after me is not worthy of me." Here he just hits the nail straight to the head. We have earthly connections, and what are the most strong, the strongest earthly connections, if not the family? And those who didn't grow up in a Christian family, you know it too well, the same like I know it. When I came to the faith and I embraced the Bible truth as it's written in the Bible, you had enemies in your own home. Isn't that true? Were they not against you, telling you, what are you doing? You will be different, you are weird, you are ashamed to the family. Maybe they didn't say that, but they were not comfortable. At least they were not comfortable. They disagreed even before they start to study to see what it's about. They want to know. Takes from us a bit of courage to go the whole way and to become worthy of Jesus. Jesus says something else interesting, and he says, "Of him who is ashamed of me before the people, before the men, before the world, I will also be ashamed when I'm coming in my glory with the holy angels." He will be ashamed also before his Father. Do we want Jesus to be ashamed of us? Or do we want him to be proud with us and to say, "Well done, my good and faithful servant, come, come, your battle is finished. Now come and enjoy the rest, the endless rest and peace which I prepared for you." In Romans chapter 1, verses 16 and 17, Paul is saying, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ." Why he is not ashamed with the gospel of Christ? This takes everything. It's more precious than the mother and the father and the job and even the food, even the life itself on this earth. Because the gospel of Christ is the power of God to salvation of everyone who believes. "For in it, the righteousness of God is revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, the just shall live by faith." How shall live the just? By faith. What sort of faith? What faith are we talking about? In what?
In
what?
In
God and His plan. In the gospel. Not in the leader of the church. Or of a preacher. Of a whoever on earth. Which they as well need salvation. At the end of time, a group of people on earth will come to a full understanding of the gospel, and they will pronounce that which Jesus omitted when his ministry started. And we see in Revelation 14, in verse 6 and 7, it says, "And I saw another angel flying in the midst of heaven, having the everlasting gospel, to preach unto them that dwell on the earth, and to every nation and kindred and tongue and people, to everyone, to the whole world." This is a worldwide message, saying with what voice? Loud voice. They are not just whispering. Fear God and give glory to Him. The word fear, to be understood as reverence God, give glory, give honor. "For the hour of His judgment is come." Can you see it? That is exactly what He omitted in that day when He started His ministry. But this group of people, which at the end of time will preach for the last time the gospel to the whole world, they will bring into the picture that the hour of His judgment is come. And he's telling to people, worship him that made the heaven, the earth, the sea, and the foundations of water. We are there now. It's no time to go around and to don't warn people of what is coming. Because the time is near. We don't know how near, but surely it's near. We can see it all around us. Read Matthew 24, whole chapter. Read 2 Peter 3. And you'll see how it should look, the end of times. You'll be amazed how what you read there matches perfectly with this state of the world today. Is something very interesting about verse 7 here, because you say, worship him that made heaven and earth and sea, because people are so confused now. It's not even, you are not even allowed to speak about God. Keep your religion at home. And still these people will not love their life here as to keep quiet and to keep it for themselves. But they will warn people, those who want to hear the gospel, the message, those who are seeking, not push through people's throat the gospel, but find the people who are seeking for something better, who are seeking for escape from this place of destruction. And we can see that is such a parallel between the verse in Revelation 14:7 with chapter 20 of Exodus, where we read the commandment about the Sabbath. It says, "Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy." And I highlighted the word "remember" because God, in His knowledge, in His understanding, in His foreseeing the things in the future, He knew that the Sabbath will be forgotten. So He says, "Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days shalt thou labor and do all thy work, but the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord thy God." It's not ours, it's His. "In it thou shalt not do any work, thou, nor thy son, nor thy daughter, thy manservant, nor thy maidservant, nor thy cattle, not even the stranger that is within your gates." Why? Why? Because in 6 days the Lord made heaven and the earth, the sea and all that in them is, and rested the seventh day. Therefore the Lord blessed and the Sabbath day and hallowed it. That is, made it sanctified, sanctified that day. So if he blessed and sanctified the seventh day, surely all the other are not sanctified and blessed. Would be mentioned there, don't you think? One day of the seven is blessed and sanctified, the seventh. Not the first, not the second, not the so on. And we know that we meet here today because this is the holy day and the sanctified day of God. This is the appointment which God created for our sanctification, for our holiness, for our meeting with Him. If the Queen arranges an appointment with you for a certain day and for a certain hour, in vain you are going there next day. In vain you are going there before, because she will be there when she said she will be. And you, as a somebody which you are in a lower position than the Queen, you should better be there in time. So you can see there, to worship Him that made the heaven, earth and the sea, and there again, made the heaven, earth and sea, you can see how clearly is a pointing towards the fourth commandment, to the Sabbath commandment. That is in the end of time. Let's don't forget, for hundreds of years, people lost the knowledge of the Sabbath the year 321 after Christ until 200 years ago, 300 years ago, because there was no printed Bible. Was called the Dark Ages, and the people who supposed to bring light to the masses, that was the priests and the papacy of the Catholic Church, kept people in the darkness, in the superstition, in fear, and they persecuted those who were reading the Bible for themselves. You were not allowed to have a Bible. So obviously, if you don't have the knowledge of the truth, you might as well accept anything you are told that the truth is, isn't it? So you are an easy prey to be told, oh, for your salvation you need to pay that much money. For the salvation of your brother who just died, or mother or father, you need to pay that much money. And of course, you are going and paying that much money, hoping that the soul of your poor mother will come out of that terrible place called, I don't know, hell, purgatory, call it how you want, a place of torment, and will come out and will be released from that terrible pain. That is a terrible, terrible deception, which they used to make a lot of money. So when you go and visit important Catholic places, remember that all that beautiful places are built with deception and with much, much torture and death of the martyrs. In Revelation 12:17 we read, the dragon, that is about the end of time. We're talking about the end of time right now. The dragon was wroth. Who is the dragon? The devil himself. The dragon was wroth with a woman and went to make war with the remnant of her seed. Who is the woman?
Church.
The church. Which keep the commandments of God and have the testimony of Jesus. Is there a group of people at the end of time which are keeping the commandments of God? Well, this is what's written. Again, in Revelation 14:12, it says, here is the patience of the saints. They are saints. Is a group of saints at the end of time. They are they that keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. How many commandments are they keeping? All of them. All 10. They are made able to keep. Is a union between human and divine, which make them able, empower them to be able to keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. Anyone can give me a thought about the faith of Jesus and the testimony of Jesus. The texts are almost similar, and you can see the parallel, but You can see there is the testimony, they have the testimony of Jesus Christ, and there is, they have the faith of Jesus. Anyone? Of course, we know that from the Bible that the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. Yeah? But apart from that, what else it is? The cross, exactly, is the life of Jesus. He sacrificed up to there that he died for his mission. Are you able? Are you interested to die for Christ? To die for you, for this mission? To lose your job over this mission? To be mocked and persecuted over this mission? How much are we going to give to Jesus back for what he's done for us? We want to see the gospel in practice. Enough talk, brethren. We need to see the gospel in practice, in reality, seen in our lives. You know, where is the most visible proof of the gospel in practice? Any idea? What is the most visible?
In our life.
Church-ish.
In our life.
Even closer. As somebody says in the church, that is the church family, yes? But I know a closer.
At home.
Exactly. At home, brethren. At home. In vain we are coming here and being nicely dressed and with hair done properly, with shoes shining, preaching from the pulpit, singing, doing the scripture reading and whatever. Because our wives, our husbands, our children knows who we are at home. Are we who we really preach? Are we what we are preaching? In Mark 16 with verse 15 it says, go into the in all the world and preach the gospel to everyone. Go into all the world and preach the gospel. How you can give somebody to others something which you don't have? First, you need to have that thing in order to give it to somebody else. Otherwise, you're just a blind leading another blind. You are full of deception and hypocrisy. So, it's time to start practicing at home, brethren. Go into the whole world and preach the gospel to every creature. That is our workplaces, our neighborhood, everyone we meet. He who believes and is baptized will be saved, but he who does not believe will be condemned. I put this verse here for a reason, because it's important to know the order of the things. What is first? To believe. And what is after believing? To get baptized, yes? There is another deception which comes through the ages. Again, using the ignorance of the people, which was not able to have the Bible in their language and to read it for themselves and to know the truth as it really was. And they were baptizing, so-called baptizing, children and calling them Christians. Emperor Constantine, when he decided that Christian is after all not such a bad thing, he decided to make his troops Christian. Do you know how he baptized them? Put them to march through the river. Doesn't matter your belief, your gods and whatever, because they were all pagans, right? Just march them through the river, and here we go. You have a baptized Christian army. Were they changed in the heart? That is my question. Were they really truly converted? What did they believe? Is to believe something to be commanded by men under the terror, under the pressure, under the fear of persecution that you may lose your soldier money, wages, or anything? No. God is calling us to come because we want to come. God is that gentleman that he accepts our choice. You don't want to come? That's fine. I will let you be. But he, in his goodness, is putting before us the life and the death. It's our choice. No pressure. It's just a loving call. Those who will be baptized will be saved. Is baptism important? Is it important? Why? I tell you why. Because baptism is the proof that you are not ashamed of Christ. That is what it is. My mom acknowledged the truth about the Sabbath, but my mom is too proud a person to go before the people and admit that she was wrong all her life, and to go into the baptistry and to be baptized. She believes that if she was baptized when she was a baby, that's good enough. I wish her that her hopes and her belief are truth, but I'm afraid it's a deception, and she needs to have a converted heart. And a converted heart is not ashamed of Christ anymore. Before you are, when you are not converted, like this you know if you are converted or not. When you are shy and embarrassed and you don't want to speak about Christ and you want to keep it for yourself, you are not converted. When you are converted, you want to tell everyone. What you want to tell them? The good news. You've got it. You have something so good and it's free that you want everyone to have it. You see everywhere people in suffering, people with burdens, and you want them to release that burden. Just give this burden of yours to this guy here, Jesus Christ is called. This Jesus Christ, his name, he is amazing. He will be your best friend. He will take all your burden. He will give you his peace, a peace which surpasses all understanding. Are you willing? It's a call which we give to people. We don't force nobody. We just do what Christ called us to do. There need to be a baptism. Is the gospel real in my life? We come back to the picture we had in the beginning, because I want to focus a little bit on this picture. What is made of this cross? What is made of? Yeah, okay. But
tree?
Yeah, okay, yeah, that's fine. But there are two pieces. Yeah? Are two pieces there. Can you see? One is horizontal, one is vertical. Even the cross itself is teaching us a sermon. They are united together. They are not separate. The small bit is the horizontal bit is the relation between humans. The long bit is the relation between human and God. Can you see it? Together, that is the gospel. The cross is a relationship. Let's put it relationships. And we see that has two dimensions, very important. Till now we spoke about the first dimension. In Matthew 22, 36 to 40, it says, "Teacher, which is the great commandment in the law?" Other translation says, "Which is the greatest commandment in the law?" Or more, most relevant or most important. What is that most important thing which I need to do to be saved? And Jesus said to him, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind." And he follows saying, "This is the first and the greatest commandment." And guess what? He could stop there, but he didn't. He carries on and he says, "And the second is like it." Can you see the cross? Together, the horizontal and the vertical will just not go away from each other. "And the second is like it, you shall love your neighbor as yourself." That is the gospel. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. You want to be saved? You want to know what the gospel is? You want all the Bible in just two sentences? Here it is. "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind." You'll not be embarrassed to speak about Jesus and to reflect Jesus in your life, wherever you are in the family, at workplaces, wherever you go. This is you. It's part of your inner soul. This is who you are. "And also you shall love your neighbor as yourself." That is the gospel. In Galatians, now I'm talking about the vertical. Till now I spoke the, this will be much shorter. Till now I spoke about the vertical, our duty to God. Now we are talking about the horizontal. In Galatians chapter 5, verses 22 and 23, we can see what is the fruit of the Spirit. The fruit, one fruit, not the fruits, one fruit, the fruit of the Spirit. Because you see, we might try to love our God with all our heart and all our soul and all our mind. You know, this was the Pharisee, the Pharisees was doing that. They were following by letter every requirement they were fulfilling. But their heart was not towards their fellow man. They done everything out of duty, not out of the, you know, that
love.
That love. Yeah, that bond of love which the Bible talks about. The fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance, and again, against such things there is no law. Brethren, for the last two times when I preached in this place was about marriage. And I have a burden for marriages because I know there are many families which are struggling. Maybe even in this place there are a husband and a wife which are not right. Are we reflecting the fruit of the Spirit? With this we should acknowledge if we are touched by the gospel or the gospel just is a theory which we can talk about all day long. I believe and I hope with all my heart and I pray with all my heart that God change my life daily towards this goal, towards having more and more the fruit of the Spirit. We need to reflect this in our families. When we will reflect this in our families, our churches will be stronger. The world will have something to see which they don't have. And they will love to come around, to learn from of that special thing which we have and they don't. Because they would see so much happiness that they would not want to go anywhere else. People don't run away from happiness. If it's a treasure somewhere, people queue. Especially if it's for free. Every day we should think, how is the gospel in practice in our homes? Are we getting angry? Are we using a high tonality voice? What sort of words are we using? All these things glorify God, or rather glorify Satan. Even worse, that we every Sabbath are here and pretend to be something which we are actually not. In the Ministry of Healing, page 469, Sister Ellen White writes something which moved my heart. Two things he writes. She said, there is an eloquence far more powerful than the eloquence of words in a quiet, consistent life of a pure, true Christian. What a man is has more influence than what he says. And now please remember forever these next words. The strongest argument in favor of the gospel is a loving and lovable Christian. I repeat, the strongest argument is nothing stronger than that. In favor of the gospel is the loving and lovable Christian. Are you a loving Christian? Are we a lovable Christian? Are feeling people distressed around us or maybe comfortable? Are they just wait to be in our company or they don't know how to go away from us? We need to think about these things, brethren. I'll shock you now. We'll go to the next slide and we read about love. And think of these words in relation to your own marriages, in your own families, in your own relationships, especially with those in your home. Love suffers long and is kind. Love does not envy. Love does not parade itself, is not puffed up, does not behave rudely, does not seek its own, is not easily provoked, and thinks no evil, does not rejoice in iniquity, but rejoices in the truth. The love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, and endures all things. That is Jesus Christ. He endured till the end. We are his followers. We have a path of struggle. And now comes the shock. Because there are people among us, very sad to say, who believe that the gospel touched them because they know the scripture by heart, because they know the spirit of prophecy, because they know they are aware of all the timetable of the events to come, everything in the right order. They will tell you and preach you exactly how the things is going to happen, and will tell you how everything is going to be. And here is the shock. Though I speak with the tongues of men and of angels, but have no love, I have become sounding brass and clanging cymbal. That means I make noise for nothing. And though I have the gift of prophecy and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and though I have all faith so that I could remove mountains, but have no love, I am what? Nothing. Nothing. Can you imagine this guy here I'm talking about? That he believes he is right because he has the knowledge, he knows the Bible even by heart, and he thinks he has the right to the eternal life. And he will have a massive surprise to hear that you are nothing. All your knowledge is zero. I would rather have the love than the knowledge, don't you? Well, it's beautiful if you have them both. But I know one thing. I have a problem with my memory. Glory to God. I don't know why. I would like to be how I was when I was 16, 17. I promise you, I had a brilliant mind, a wonderful memory. I could see a number plate. I would remember it tonight. I would remember all the lies I'm saying. If I had to lie again, I would know what to lie because I remember all my lies. And today I'm giving glory to God for what He took away from me, because I'm not able to lie, because that would be a disaster. I wouldn't remember what I said, and I would lie something else, and I would be caught immediately. So rather say the truth.
Yeah.
If you say the truth, you can't go wrong. Because even the truth remained the same truth next week after, and next 2 years after, and so on. So you are on the safe side. So I don't understand why, but I'm sure God has a very good explanation why my mind is gone, my remembrance, my memory. But glory to Him. My hope is not in this life and the benefits which the memory would bring me, because it was a big benefit. I was something else. But that is gone, so don't worry. You are safe around me. And though, listen this one here, and though I bestow all my goods to feed the poor, can you realize what sort of guy is this one? He has all the faith to move the mountains, he is doing miracles. He is so willingful to give all the money to the poor that others would flourish and he would give everything. Even he is giving his body to be burned. But I have no love. It profits me nothing. What is more important here? Can you see it?
No.
Brethren, the call is to put it in practice in our lives, to make a difference in our homes, to make it real. When we'll be real at home, we'll be real everywhere. If your wife, if your husband, if your children, neighbor, colleagues from work, boss, whoever, will have nothing wrong to say against you, but only words of consideration, then the gospel is real in your life. But if they hear you shouting, even bad words, you should think again about the authenticity of the gospel in your life. Amen. Thank you, Sorin. Powerful again. We need the love. We need to have our head knowledge as heart knowledge. Shall we sing the closing hymn? Burden of lifted Calvary. Involves a Calvary. That involves to take up our cross and follow Jesus Christ. His life of self-denial is an example for us. Help us, Lord, not to be ashamed and embarrassed with your name, but be true lights in this world, especially, Lord, in our families. Lord, we ask for the Holy Spirit to transform our minds, to bring to our remembrance the words we've heard today and the words of comfort which you gave us. Help us to trust in you every day of our lives. no matter in what circumstances we may be. Help us to fear nothing, but with your name on us, to obtain victory in your name. Lord, give us power, make us holy, and prepare us in this journey, bring us closer and closer to the sanctification of our mind and heart and soul and body, that we may be a temple for your Holy Spirit, that you may dwell in us. Lord, I pray for all those people who heard this message today to take it home and make practice in their lives. May all the world see these families, that there is something special about these families, and to be drawn with questioning, what is this special thing which they don't have but they want? Give us, Lord, that peace which surpasses all understanding, which only Jesus can give. Lord, we thank you for this Sabbath day and for the truth, for the bread of life which you gave us today. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
6. Loss and sorrow often give birth to hymns, such as the case of More Love to Thee by Elizabeth Peyton Prentice. For much of her life she lived the life of a near invalid, her body often racked with pain. It was during these times that she had to refocus her understanding of her own value and worth from doing to being. See now that to live for God, whether one is allowed ability to be actively useful or not, is a great thing, and that it is a wonderful mercy to be allowed even to suffer, if thereby one can glorify him. More Love to Thee emerged out of a time of personal tragedy. During the 1850s, the Prentices lost a child, and shortly thereafter a second. Through her grief, she confided in her diary, empty hands, a worn out, exhausted body, and unutterable longings to flee from a world that has so many sharp experiences. Prentice completed the 4 stanzas of her hymn in a single evening, but never showed it to anyone for 13 years. On one occasion, Prentice wrote, "To love Christ more is the deepest need, the constant cry of the soul. Out in the woods and on my bed and out driving, when I am happy and busy and when I am sad and idle, the whisper keeps going up for more love, more love, more love."
Should be.